Hey, Sushan. Not many people talked about Halloween this year as far as RPGs go. Usually around Halloween, this is years ago, people would come up with these videos. What are some good Halloween adventures to run during Halloween? Well, COVID sort of put the kibosh on that. Now that COVID's over and is starting up again, people are still people are still what's the word? Untrusting, so they don't want to get anyone's hopes up, so no one's bringing it up. I mean, it makes sense. This guy, I watched some of it already. Yeah, let's just hit play.
Hey folks, I'm JC from One Shot Adventures, and I don't know about you, but I'm in the mood for horror. And so today I'm going to talk about one of my favorite types of horror adventures, what makes a great haunted house adventure. So you can either run one for your friends, or you can design your own creepy haunted house masterpiece. Now, haunted houses are just perfect for RPGs. They're contained, they're full of surprises and traps and backstory, and they work in almost any genre. Like, some of my favorite adventures of all time are haunted houses, like Call of Cthulhu's The Haunted.
They work in any genre? I'll agree with that. Any genre, you can introduce horror material. Heck, in a comic book, everything's hunky-dory, and then this woman's head is chopped off. She's like one of the main characters. That was pretty grisly. Not expecting that. In a comic book. A main character. But how often can you get away with that with your players, if you every game session you introduce some horrific thing that happens. And can you do it? The thing is, can you do it? Oftentimes these things come off as fun houses, not haunted houses.
Hunting, or Dungeons and Dragons, Sinister Secret of Saltmarsh, or even in science fiction like the alien RPGs, Chariot of the Gods. All that said, haunted houses can be tricky to run. If you're not careful, your haunted house might play out like an undercooked dungeon, with a worse layout and a slower pace, and your players just would go room to room without really a sense of why anything matters. In comparison to dungeons, which are actually
Yeah, if the dungeon master isn't narrating or describing things right away, if they're being passive and letting the players do the exploration and finding things out, the pacing bogs down, it gets really slow. The players are doing their mother may I questions. They're trying to solve the mystery of the mansion from the front door without coming in the house. And then when they go in the house, they're told by the GM, this is what you guys see, this is what you guys see, you see this is what you see. In this room, you see this. It's like, okay, so you're giving the players the grand tour of the haunted house. Okay. And it's a fun house on top of that, because the players are goofing off. They're not role playing. They're acting like they're kids on a Disneyland theme park ride. And the mom's telling them to stay in their seat. Don't get off the ride. Don't get off the ride until it's over. That begins to happen in your game session.
pretty
Not
easy
mine.
to run
Not my sessions, of course.
in RPGs, haunted houses have their own unique challenges. First, haunted houses are entirely open-ended. Unlike a dungeon, which can have linear flows with choke points and multiple pathways, haunted
Haunted houses could be the same thing. Okay, technically a haunted house is a dungeon. If you really want to know, if you really want to know, a haunted house is a dungeon. Just with different skin is all. What is he going to say? The haunted house is open world? Open. You can go in or out the way you came in? What?
Enchanted houses are not linear at all. A house's entrance is the same as its exit, and your players fully understand.
What? Tell me you're not using this as your floor plan. 1980s floor plan for houses. Let me guess, the fireplace here is double-sided. So the master bedroom gets to see the fire as well as the living room. How about this? Let there be different entrances and exits to your haunted house. How about that? You don't have to do what the book says. Trust me, the books are crap. Unless you know what you're getting into and you understand what, like who in the business is a decent horror fiction writer, until you do that, don't use what's pre-written in a book.
Understand how to explore a house already. They'll expect things like kitchens and bathrooms and bedrooms, which means there can be fewer locational surprises. And for haunted houses to really feel right, they need to be slower paced. If your house forces the...
Does it? Pacing? Slow burn? High octane. I like both. Depends. Session zero. What are we going to do? What are we going to roleplay? What haven't we done yet? Do we want it to be roller coaster? Do we want it to be slow paced? Slow burn? You know, with the cool reveal at the end. Is it just fast-paced and we go through it all with our minds still intact somewhat? You know, players get to choose. Hey, players can make interesting characters based on the pacing of the game. If they know ahead of time. You don't want to be doing a fast-paced game if you got this slow, methodical, self-reflecting character who has a melancholy, whatever, sort of a personality, melancholy, and, interpersonal, whatever, likes to do inner monologues with themselves. Maybe they had issues. Maybe it's a coming home thing. They've been away. They've been to university for a while. They're coming home. Coming home to their old stomping grounds. And maybe they're at home in a haunted house. Maybe they come home and they're like, what happened to my house I grew up in? Where are my parents, I wonder? Now, what if he killed his parents and then went off to university and then he's decided to drop out of university and come back home? See how the old neighborhood is doing. Do players do that kind of stuff in a horror game? Of course not. Hell no. Characters don't make cool, interesting characters for a horror session. For a horror session, one shot or two shot. Nope. Players are going to do their Scooby-Doo characters. And they're going to go through the place like it's a fun house. Playing Mother May I.
Players to fight room by room, like fighting skeletons and goblins. It's just...
What's scary about that? You know, Buffy the Vampire Slayer was a TV show, and it was kind of scary. It didn't do stupid things like this all the time, you know? Know what I mean?
Not gonna feel like a haunted house. And the things that work in horror movies, like jump scares and tight camera angles and fake outs, are just notoriously difficult, if not impossible, to pull off at the table. So these add up to a lot of challenges for GM.
Now, jump scares are real easy to do. It's timing. You just have to time it. When I say, oh, it would be cool if there was a jump scare right here, and then there is. It's like, okay, I'm reading someone's mind. Because they just had the jump scare when I was saying, this would be a good place for a jump scare. But here's the thing. If the players aren't even looking at you or the screen when you're playing online and you do a jump scare online and the players are just kind of like eating their peas and cabbage while listening to what's going on, they're going to miss the jump scare.
Who want to run a cool haunted house for their friends. But recently, I've thought a lot about haunted houses, so I'm going to give you some tips today on how to run a great one.
You do the one of the jump scares you do is you show something kind of eerie or creepy with a slow audio of a voice saying something, and the players have to turn up their speakers to hear what's being said in the video clip. And then they're all leaning in trying to hear, and then the speakers blast with sound and jump scare video right there. It's an old trick. I used to use that work. I'd say, hey, watch this. Here's a video. I emailed you a link to a video. It's kind of cool. And I don't say what the video is. And later on in the day when I see them, they're all nervous. They're all jittery. They're in shell shock. I don't say, gosh, what happened? I know they watched the video. And they're not the same after that, which is cool. Now, do that now. This is like 20 years ago. Do that now. Oh, they come after you. You get sent to prison.
YouTube Premium is ad-free YouTube. And exclusive access to all things.
Number one, the house's history is everything. Fundamental to a great haunted house is a deep, often intricate backstory.
No, don't info dump the players. For God's sakes, don't do that. The Disneyland haunted house ride. Does it info dump the riders, the people on the rides? No, it doesn't. Show, don't tell. Show, don't tell.
Story. Unlike a dungeon where it pretty much doesn't matter like who built it, they can.
It doesn't matter who built it because role players are crap role players these days, always have been. The players don't care about your story, dude. They don't care about your dungeon. Why would they care about the haunted house? Okay, so my players don't like my dungeons ever. They refuse to roleplay my game. So this time we're going to play a scary, horror haunted house adventure instead of D&D. This time they're going to be scared, I bet. More like bore the players with your info dump on the house. You're using the same players from your D&D sessions. They're crap role players. Are they just magically going to be interested in your haunted Halloween adventure one shot? Are they instantly going to be role playing masterfully? No. Are they going to listen about the history of the stupid house they're going to be put in? No. Are they going to play the game like it's a haunted game? No. They're going to play it like D&D players. They're going to try to do all the D&D things in your haunted house. I don't like it when these GM guys lie to me about how to do the things.
It could all be built by long forgotten sorcerers with unclear motivations, and it's just fine. Your players don't usually care. But haunted houses need to have backstories for your players to care. They need to have...
I just said they don't. Do we have a backstory for Bates Motel? Do we have a backstory for that? Did we have a backstory for Burnt Offerings? Heck, the freaking Halloween Disneyland vinyl record from 68. Did that haunted house have a backstory? No. People play it still to this day. As you're walking up to their door to get candy, you hear the haunted house record playing, blasting from the dining room window. There's no backstory on the record.
They're foundations built by the stories and the personalities that lived in the house as it became haunted and before the PCs walk in.
Oh my God. See, that's Scooby-Doo crap. You playing Clue? Are you going to be playing Clue in the house? I thought you wanted to scare the people. Oh, we're going to go look up everyone's genealogy trees and crap. And do we need to dust for fingerprints? Nope. These people have been dead for hundreds of years. How come no one's moved in this house? Oh, I don't know. What does the lore dump say about it?
Again, like everything in the house should tie back to the event that made it haunted. Like, houses shouldn't just have bedrooms, but you should know who lived in each bedroom. Their portraits should be on the wall, and there should be journals.
Really? So the players need to have the answers to everything? Why was the place haunted? Who made it haunted? Why is it still haunted? What is it haunted of? Really? Sounds like a frustrated storyteller trying to read his book to his players, and he wants his players to know all the details. He's going to have a GMPC in the game that's going to help them solve all the clues as to why the house is haunted. So now the players have turned into scavenger hunters, looking for the clues, instead of being scared. The mystery of the haunted house. It's like, the mystery of the used to be haunted house. Not as haunted as ever, or not as haunted as in the past for reasons. Let's investigate, shall we?
Journals, and just make sure as you build the house that you kind of understand the story of what happened there and who lived.
Why? What does it matter? If you made a scary dungeon, is it because everyone knew about all the backstory of the dungeon and who all the dead skeletons and stuff were? Are the players concerned about that? Oh, I killed the guy's half-sister. Oh, look, I killed one of his harem types. Oh, this skeleton is just a neighbor who got stuck in his house once. Oh, and this skeleton is the priest who married him to his wife. I guess the wife skeleton is going to show up too.
There, I find that physical items are often the best way to reinforce the history of a house, and it's a fun way for players to discover what happened.
Fun? For fuck you say. Fun. What is this fun you talk of? So no roleplay. So this is a party trick game? This is just a party game of yours? Just a fun house party game for your players? Are they paying you to do this? Why put such low effort into this? What's the reward for running a game like this for your friends? It was fun. I hope you had fun in our session. The hell? The title says, create epic chills. See? Create epic chills. A great haunted house adventure. Okay, let's do it. I don't want to hear about any more Funhouse game sessions where everyone's playing Clue, trying to figure out what happened, and you're not telling anything because you're leaving it up to the players to find the clues to figuring it out on. Now, every character now is some sort of investigator. Some who don't even have investigation skills, whatever. One's a taxi driver, one's a boxer, one's an ex-con. Why are they all in the house together? And you want the players themselves to all figure out the puzzles. You want the players themselves to use their noggin and do some private eye investigation stuff. You know, the player's the one who figures the thing out, not the characters. The characters are just pogs in the rooms. The GM gets to move the pogs around. And It's just gruesome. It's just horrific. It is horrific what the hobby has done to itself in the last 40-something years.
Happened. Set up the existence of a few special items early on in the adventure, so when they're found by the players, it immediately creates history and tension. So for
Okay, so the amulet. Someone finds the amulet. And one of the characters is kind of, what's the word? Not a kleptomaniac. But she does think of herself as deserving of other people's things. She puts the amulet on. It immediately chokes her to death. Cuts her head off. How about this? She puts it on. She looks in the mirror. And it's sucking the life out of her. She's aging 10 years every 30 seconds. She better take it off. She's convinced herself that it will correct itself and make her look beautiful. No, she's going to die. Or she puts it on. It immediately burns a hole in her chest. Like, just like acid just drips from the amulet and just burns through her body. That'd be a cool shot, right? The amulet is swinging. Instead of it swinging this way, back and forth on her neck, it's swinging this way, back and forth through her chest, through her spine. And her body kind of goes, her spine is gone. She just has a gaping hole. Anyway. No? No one wants to do that with her character? Nope.
For example, if an NPC tells the PCs at the beginning of the adventure,
"All I heard was screaming, and as I ran from the house, the last thing I saw was an old doll with golden hair."
Well, your players are going to be on edge until they finally find that doll. And then, of course, you need to have a story of why that doll matters and why they might be a little creeped out by it. Flavorful but also useless items often help add to the backstory of the house too. For example, in my adventure that I wrote, Thrusher Manor.
Of course, he wrote one. Can't you just ad lib stuff like I do? You have to write a fucking novel. Frustrated writers have no business running these games.
And you can watch an overview of it right up here. I placed these convict-style placards throughout the house.
Of course.
Ignorant and stupid, vile backstabber, sinful and treasonous, etc. And while these were not key to the plot of the adventure, when the...
Yeah, they're sort of out of place, don't you think? Now, if you're doing an escape room scenario and you have these signs, and they're sort of a puzzle, Twilight Zone kind of a thing... Whoever's worthy to remove the sign, that kind of thing, gets entry into the next area. Who knows? Whoever's character matches the sign, personality-wise, maybe something will happen. But who put the signs there? Where's that guy at? Is he on the megaphone? Is he on the PA system? Is he videotaping all this? You know, the people stuck in the escape room that's haunted. That's another cool way to do one, a haunted house.
The players found them and immediately gave them a sense that the house's prior inhabitants were just awful people who liked making fun of each other, like they hung signs on each other. I also...
Oh, yeah, I can think of 100 more creepy things that the previous occupants could have been doing to each other that could be relayed to the players somehow without reading a fucking book first.
I recently talked to a GM who loved haunted houses, and she said one of her favorite techniques was planting a few mirrors in the house. So when the PCs walked past them, they would get glimpses of what had happened in the past in that room with the mirror in it. I thought that was really
cool. Yeah, you want to tell your story. You want to make sure the players know all of the story. How about this? The players only know half of what's going on. They're kind of busy right now to be preoccupied with knowing the rest of the story. They're kind of dealing with the now. They're dealing with the information they have now. These GMs, they want to make sure, they want to tell the whole story to the players. Make sure every last nook and cranny has been looked at. Every mouse hole in the wall has been looked at. God damn it. What part of my story did you like the best? None of it. I'm just glad it's over.
Cool. You should totally do that too. Number two, start the adventure before the PCs arrive at the house.
Well, that makes sense. Worlds are in motion. Settings are in motion. Events are in motion. It's just whether or not when the players encounter the house. The house is an encounter. When will the players encounter it? The house isn't waiting for the players. Things are happening. Is it a Tuesday? Was it a Wednesday when the players showed up at the house? Kind of important to know, right?
Because history is so important to a great haunted house adventure, you should actually start the adventure somewhere else. This gives you the opportunity.
Like where? At a hotel down the street? At the other end of the universe? Start it with a car running out of gas or a flat tire, and it just happens to be in front of the house? Where do you start your story, my friend?
To establish the history of your house before the players arrive.
Send a letter to each character. It is of vital importance that you meet such and such at this house at such and such time. More will be revealed when you arrive. Thank you for your time.
Add a scene or two at the beginning of the adventure where you can spread spooky rumors about the house.
Ooh, spooky. Now, how do you spread a spooky rumor? Because most chuckleheads can't even do a rumor. How are they going to do a spooky one? You know, most DMs, when they do a rumor, the players ignore it. One thing the players aren't, they're not role-playing their character. They're playing themselves in a game. Most players just play themselves in a game. Or they're playing a figment of their imagination of what they would be like if they were in the game. And if they're not interested in rumors in real life, guess what? Guess what?
And build expectations that you should subvert later. For example, you could have somebody at the local bar describe the time that their uncle visited the house.
Yeah, my Uncle Greg went into that house once.
Give it up. Give it up. Retire your YouTube channel.
Went running clear out because he said he found a dead body in the basement with its eyes burned out.
Ooh. Now, if this was Detroit, this is every other house. What makes this house so special?
Number three, use real floor plans. Okay, so this tip is mostly for the people who are gonna write their own haunted house adventure. But if you are, remember that it's key to a haunted house that it actually feels like a house. It shouldn't feel like a dungeon made out of wood with some old carpet in it. And fortunately, there's a lot.
What does that mean? Feels like a house, not a dungeon. I'm guessing more people have watched haunted house movies than dungeon movies. So they can probably describe a house better than a dungeon. That could be why most D&D games are crap. Because no one knows what a dungeon looks like. Because there's hardly any movie references to D&D. Who knows? Maybe I'm optimistic in thinking that players should be playing haunted house games. Because more players are familiar with thriller movies, slasher films, supernatural films. Why do I even bother? Most players are chuckleheads. They can't even remember a movie 2 minutes after they've seen it. So how are they going to fucking role play afterwards in a game based on a movie they just saw?
A lot of floor plans of old houses on the internet. Just grab one of them and use it, and then your house will instantly feel like a lived-in real place.
The fuck you say? That's his hidden, most darkest secret to the trade?
It's actually interesting. Floor plans and architecture has evolved a lot over the last few centuries, so if you...
No, it hasn't. It has not. You can have a house made. You can have a cottage house made to 1911 specifications. You can have a Frank Lloyd Wright house made to fucking specifications. What else? What other house is left to build? A glass house? I'm gonna live in a glass mini house. No doors. I just come in through the roof somehow. I don't know. I kind of know something about architecture. I can tell you the history of it. People like Spanish Revival, especially in Los Angeles area. I don't blame him.
Go grab an old floor plan. It will still feel a little bit alien to players, like things will not quite be where people from today's day and era expect. And that's a good thing because your haunted house will still feel familiar, but also a little bit off. So go raid the internet archives and find some cool old floor plans and you won't regret.
Use AI. Just use AI. Just tell the AI you want a spooky floor plan. Done. Problem solved.
Got it. Also, remember that it's okay in a haunted house if ordinary rooms outnumber the exciting ones. I think a good haunted house only has about a third of the rooms deep.
You don't even need rooms in your haunted house, if you catch my drift. Does this place have a basement? Does it have an attic? Does it have a backyard deck thing going on? Is there a swimming pool? Does it have water in it? Does it have floating bodies in it? Like, what the hell do you need rooms for? You gonna give a grand tour to your players? Is that what you're fucking gonna do, is give a tour to your fucking players? Got 10 bedrooms, 7 bathrooms. We're gonna see all of it. And then you treat it like a dungeon creep. You're in a room. It's 10 by 3 by 7. You know, that kind of nonsense.
Deeply tie into the horrible events that curse the place. What's important is you don't feel like you have to stock every single room in the house with something to surprise your players. Like, sometimes a bedroom can just be a bedroom and...
Okay, you're in the master bedroom. What do you guys do? Is there a bed in the... Is there a window? Is there a chandelier I can swing across to the other side of the master bedroom? Or do I need to walk across the carpet? I just want to get to the... I just want to take a look at the painting on the wall. Maybe there's a safe behind the painting. Ooh. Because while I'm here, I think I'm going to rip off this place. Because no one else has thought of doing that in the 100 years this house has been here.
And that's fine. Number 4, always bring an NPC, or two. In the movies, by the time the heroes arrive at the haunted house, it's already terrorized or murdered some poor locals. And you've usually seen what's happened in the very first scene of the movie.
I'm curious what he's going to use for the NPC. The gas station dude? The waitress? Lady, the taxi cab guy who's afraid to wait while you go look in the house. The ghost in the house. The dead ghost in the house. The tour guide. The GMPC who never dies. I'm curious what his NPC idea is.
Movie, like before the heroes get involved. You see what happens to the family, or you see somebody get murdered. You kind of get a sense of why the house is haunted.
Okay, so it's a house until someone gets murdered. Then it's a haunted house? Okay, you can go. Okay, let's say it's a fairly new house, sort of. It was built 20 years ago. Family's there. There's a party. You're invited. Everyone gets killed while you're there. One by one. A murder spree. Who did it? Who's been doing it? Who's still doing it? What mad scientist experiment was going on in the attic that the father has some sort of, secret black ops need to know experiments going on up there? He gets killed first, and then whatever killed him just proceeds to murder everyone up and down the street. So now all the houses are crazy haunted. What do you do?
However, in RPGs, which mostly focus on the players, there's less of an opportunity to show a house at its most hellish moment. So that's where NPCs come in handy. NPCs serve triple duty in haunted house adventures. First, they're great for imparting some of the house's history to the players.
Oi, guys, check it out!
No. No, you don't do that with NPCs. You don't do info dumps with your NPCs.
It's a painting of Bloody Anne, the vampire queen herself, and her hell.
Oh, this guy sucks. You suck! It's like Seth Skorkowski, but worse.
Hellhound. Yeah, the Hellhound does look cuter than I expected, I admit that. But don't let it fool you. He can breathe fire and his ears smell like yeast.
Second, NPCs can drive the plot forward in a natural way when the PCs miss clues or overlook details in the house that are important to the mystery.
Hey!
No details should be important. When you're doing these kind of games, your players should be able to figure the things out without finding every freaking clue there is. And don't be telling them where the clues are. Oh, in here you see the journal. Oh, in here you see the bloody knife. Oh, look, there's a body. It still has DNA under its fingernails from somebody it fought with. I wonder who that belongs to.
Hey guys, I found this creepy book in the library, and it looks important. I bet it has family secrets in it.
Finally.
Oh, how annoying. The NPC's finding the shit. This is arcane torture, that's what this is.
The NPCs can and should fall victim to the house's evil machinations long before the PCs get into its crosshairs. Like, if you hear Hobo Billy getting murdered in the basement by a giant spider.
It's not spiders!
Well, that's far more effective than just attacking your.
Show, don't tell. How the NPC's in the basement? And the players are like, huh, let's take our characters into the basement also and see what happened to that NPC that was with us earlier today. That's when they see the spider chewing them up. Don't have them hearing it from upstairs or whatever. It's like, oh, okay, I guess he's dead. They all chuckle. That's what players do now.
PCs with one at first. When I wrote my adventure, Thresher Manor, I made sure that all of the NPCs in it are utterly expendable after, like...
What a crap game you wrote.
The first third of the adventure. And so far, I've only ever seen one or two actually survive it. And that works great. Feels like there's a higher body count than there really is, and it gives you as a GM more tools to make the house seem evil and out to get people.
I guess in his book, you want it to seem to the players that they can get killed, that there's danger. You want it to seem like there's danger in the house. Okay, what is this part? I'm afraid to watch more of this.
You know, thinking about this a little bit, I'm going to lay down a GM challenge. You know how I said in the movies, they almost always start with the scene of the family getting terrorized by the house and they...
Don't watch the crappy movies. Why are you watching the crappy movies?
Rush out, and then here come the heroes, the investigators, to figure out what's gone on with this house. Well, I think it'd be cool if you started your haunted house adventure letting your players play that family. And yeah, they're all totally expect.
You think? How about they play the family when the house is intact? They all get murdered, and now they're ghosts. How about this? They get murdered, new characters show up. Same players, but new characters show up to figure out what happened. What happened in this place? The original characters can't speak. They're dead, and they won't know anyway what killed them. It's new to them. Okay, what's your answer to this?
Bendable, and they're all going to get messed up and lose their sanity, if not their lives. But then you could do a hard cut, and then your players take over the investigators, kind of knowing what that house is up to. I think that'd be a cool thing to try. If you've done so.
Doesn't sound scary, though. Isn't this supposed to, be horror? Epic chills. Horror. Not Scooby-Doo investigation time. Playing Clue again, and your players are fucking D&D players, so that's like that's the worst thing, having D&D players in your other games, and they don't know any other game other than D&D, so guess what they're gonna bring to the table.
Something like that. Let me know in the comments below. I might do that next.
Another one.
Number 5, embrace the sandbox and give your players multiple motivations. Because of the open layout of most houses, it's difficult to plan clear beginnings.
Open layout? It's a trap. You said that one way in, one way out? That's a trap. Well, there's no open layout. Every room has a door. It's not Frank Lloyd Wright. You know, it's not an open room structure. Open space. There's hallways and walls and corridors, dark, spooky corners. Proceed.
Middles and endings to a haunted house. You just never know, like, what's going to happen as the players roam around. And while...
Why wouldn't you ever know? You'll never know. You're running the game, right? You're running the game. Are you just waiting for cues so that you can read them some more of your story? Because you want them to know your story more than anything else? It's reading time. It's storybook time, kids. Stand around while I read you more of this book of mine. How about just pay attention to what the players are doing? The players are there to roleplay, right? We're assuming the players are at the table to roleplay. These are role-playing games. The number one reason to be at the game is to roleplay an interesting fucking character. Right? Hopefully a character they haven't played to death already a million times. Something new. Something interesting. They've invested in making their character. They're invested in exploring this crazy house of yours. And you're worried about, oh, I won't know what the players are up to. I never know what the players might do. Well, the players are in character. You're describing the house in character. It's typically an encounter. This whole thing is just an encounter between players, player characters, and a house character. Roleplay the house. What would the house do? What would the house do to the players?
Survive until dawn works fine in horror movies. That kind of simple objective will really just push your players to act like an antelope herd. They'll just roam from room to room and stick.
They do that already. Crap role players do that already. That's just, yeah. Vet your players. Make sure you have role players next time you start a game. Because role players don't do this fucking shit.
Stick together in a pack at all times. And this kind of behavior is going to make the creepiness and horror that you need for a haunted house much harder. It's just really hard to pick people off in herds, which is really key to a great haunted house adventure. So instead, what you want to do is give each PC their own custom objective on top of the larger goal. Maybe one PC wants to prove that ghosts are real. Another one.
It's a good idea. It's called a secret. Have the players make up their own secrets, though. You know what I mean? That makes sense for their character. Otherwise, what are you doing here? What are you doing here, One-Shot Adventures? You're setting up your game to be a party game. Charades, Pictionary, whodunit, who's the mole, who's the whack-a-mole. Let the players do the secret thing, and you don't know what their secret is. That's the beauty. You don't know. You don't know what the players' motivations are for their character or their goals. That's the beauty. You're just there as a referee. Saying when die rolls get made. There are die rolls in your game, right?
One is looking for a hidden treasure that's said to be in the house's basement. And a third, well, just wants to romance the cheerleader and get her alone someplace. Then you scatter clues and history and horrific events into these objectives and spread them out throughout the house. This kind of arrangement virtually guarantees that your players will separate from each other at certain points of the adventure, even if it's just for like a room or two, which is going to better enable you to kind of terrorize them as they go. There's already a great example of an adventure.
Well, killing off player characters is not terrorizing. It's not horrific. It's more of a trickle-down, hit point attrition. The players get bored easy. Eventually, they start looking for ways to heal themselves. Some people drink lots of liquor, thinking that will heal their character. Maybe it will in your setting. Who knows?
That does this. Aliens, Chariot of the Gods, and also its sequels.
These games are fun houses. I've seen them played on YouTube. Every single one of these games is a fun house. Everyone's laughing it up. No one's in character, no one's role-playing.
Like Heart of Darkness does an amazing job of giving the PCs very different, often conflicting motivations. And you can easily add this to like any adventure. Like in Call of Cthulhu's The Haunting, one time I ran that and I told...
Okay, secrets have been around since the beginning of role-playing. You don't need to rely on some expensive... coffee table art book to give you these ideas. You just don't. Just watch the good YouTube channels on the subject. Learn something.
I told one player that he was an antique dealer who was there to catalog all of the antique beds in the place so that he can win them at auction later. And this caused that player to kind of make sure he hit every bedroom in the house, and he at some point...
What's the scary part? When does the scary part kick in?
Well, he just kind of decided, like, when the other players wanted to go in the basement, he knew he was missing the master bedroom, and he went off alone, and, well, that worked out great.
The bed just moved!
And that's...
That was a good jump scare. How would that work out, though, with the main character? Because you don't want NPCs just doing that and getting themselves killed.
Everything I know about Haunted House Adventures. But if you like my thinking, don't forget to check out my free adventure, Thrusher Manor, which you can download on my blog, and it includes lots of...
Enough.